So good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Buenas noches. Welcome. Bienvenido. My name is Angie Reyes. I'm the Executive Director and Founder of Detroit Hispanic Development Corporation, and it is our honor to host this very important event here tonight. I understand that Michigan is like the second in the country in human trafficking, so this is a really important issue. So it's really wonderful to see the great turnout that we have today and all the very important people that came here to speak to the community. And I especially want to thank Consuela Lopez for all of her hard work in organizing this event tonight. I would like to now introduce the Honorable President of our City Council, Brenda Jones, who is going to give greetings. Brenda?
Good evening to everyone.
Good evening.
All right. First of all, I'd like to thank the Executive Director, Angie Reyes, and her staff for providing the Detroit Hispanic Development Corporation facility to host our first meeting on human trafficking. And I'd also like to give a special thanks to Facility Manager David Jimenez for working with my team in preparation of this town hall event. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce my team who put this event together. First of all, there is Linda Wesley, who is my Community Relations Manager. And Linda took the lead role in working with the facilitators, the panel, and the venue to pull this town hall meeting together. Then there's Jasmine Bonds. And Jasmine is my senior policy analyst. Jasmine provides important public policy information and data on human trafficking to my office. She is also going to help me to create a special initiative that we will be announcing at the conclusion of this town hall meeting. So that means don't go anyplace. Next is the newest member of my team, Christy Jensen. And you will see Christy, who will be working in the community as my office liaison along with Ray Solomon, and Christy is out at the table. They will help to ensure that important information and decisions that come from our office get back out to you in the community, and that issues and problems that are fed back into my office so that we can get a resolution for those issues. Jolene Simmons, she's also out at the table. And Jolene Simmons is my executive assistant, and Margareta Vinson, who is also at the table. She is a legislative assistant, and they handle the day-to-day operations of the office. Tonight, they are going to continue to help and assist you in any way they can. And they helped with the registration and seating, and they will continue to help you. Now, I'd like to introduce my left hand, my right hand, my side, my back, my chief of staff, and that is Stephen Grady. Stephen leads my team, and he ensures that everything runs smoothly and accordingly to plan. So if something goes wrong, don't come to me. Don't come to me. It ain't my fault. See Stephen. It's his fault. I'd like to take the opportunity to greet all of you for coming out to this town hall meeting. We have a serious problem that we have to deal with. So I thank you all for coming out. And I'd like to give a special thanks to our esteemed panel of professionals. And they are all taking time out of their busy schedule to share their knowledge, their experience, and their expertise with us in addressing this terrible problem that we are having. Are there any other elected officials and dignitaries in the office? I know I see my corporation counsel, my lawyer, Melvin Butch Hollowell. And if there's any more, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for being here to listen and learn about this topic and share any information that you have to help us address the issues that we have. So there are three things I want you to think about tonight. Between now and 8:30, there are three things. Did you know that according to national statistics, Michigan is the second highest state, the second highest state for human trafficking activity in the country? Detroit is the most active city in our state for this problem. Did you know that a youth comes up missing every 20 seconds, across the country? I'm sure you've heard the stories of Detroit youth who've been missing or who have run away from home. The problem, once they get in the streets, it's hard to find them and it's hard to save them. Our panel tonight will share some insight on what can be done if you suspect human trafficking is happening in your area. Now, did you know that human trafficking is a $38 billion global industry? $38 billion, that's a lot of money. That's the sale of people, child abduction, human organs, and free labor, which is driving the hidden economy. We, that's all of us together, we must decrease the demand so that the supply can be eliminated. I'm going to repeat that. We, that is all of us together, must decrease the demand so that the supply can be eliminated. So, for the next couple of hours, we'll all learn together about this problem and what we can do. There are two facilitators who will walk us down the road of awareness and information. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce Consuela Lopez and Special Agent Tim Wiley of the FBI. Consuela first came to our attention through her work in the community to fight against human trafficking. She is a very valuable resource in dealing with the elements of human trafficking and their effect on our community. Special Agent Wiley is part of a joint law enforcement initiative to deal with human trafficking in the Detroit area. Now, with that, I'm going to ask them to lead us into the next section of our program. Then, as we conclude, you have to look at me again. I'm going to return back with a special announcement concerning human trafficking. So make sure you stick around to hear what is coming next and how you can get involved to help us eliminate the problem that we have in the city of Detroit. So again, thank you all for being here, and I'm going to turn it over to these very capable hands to lead us through the next 2 hours.
Hola, everyone. Thank you so much, Council President Brenda Jones. Yes. Again, my name is Consuela Lopez, and unfortunately, Tim Wiley, who serves as the public affairs specialist for the FBI Detroit field office, will not be joining us this evening. He has a family emergency. So at this time, we want to send all of our positive upliftment and prayers to him and his family.
Thank you.
Thank you. So at this time, we're going to introduce our panelists, and we're going to start from left to right.
My name is Alan Williams. I'm a Detroit.
Oh, okay.
Good evening. My name is Alan Williams. I'm a Detroit police officer assigned to the Vice Enforcement Section and also assigned to the SimTech Human Trafficking Task Force.
So you can, I'm sorry, Tim just threw me off. So you can tell a little bit about what you do.
What I do is I'm assigned to the Vice Enforcement Unit, and we deal with the clubs, entertainment divisions. An aspect as to this, what we're talking about here, we deal with any kind of commercialized prostitution inside of the entertainment clubs or anything like that. I also deal with the partners of the FBI, with the SimTech Task Force, where we have running instances where we find that young girls being trafficked. We call our partners in, and I'm on that task force where we prosecute, rescue, and try to save the girls from the perpetrators that go after them. That's basically it.
Okay, hello, good evening. My name is Nicole McGee. I am a victim specialist for the FBI Detroit office. Been doing that for about 12 years. And basically my job is to attend to all victims of federal crime in my coverage area. Unfortunately, human trafficking victims are a huge portion of the victims that I serve, in particular juvenile human trafficking victims. And we are working with adult human trafficking victims as well, but the juveniles take a different approach, and a lot of times that's where I have to intervene and try to provide them with the services and the necessities for them once they are recovered, if we do operations through or with the Southeast Michigan Trafficking and Exploitation Crimes Task Force, SimTech for short. And we often come in contact with these young ladies in a variety of situations. A lot of times more than most of the time, situations they do not want to be in. They never thought that they would be in. They thought maybe that they would be, you know, whatever it is that the trafficker may have told them to get them involved in the situation. And then before they know it, they're in a situation that they can't get out of. So when we recover them, I am the one that's responsible for contacting the Department of Health and Human Services, CPS is the other name of that, to make sure that they get the right resources and get connected with all of the things that they need to be successful, is what we hope. So that's part of my job, and that's what I'm here to talk to you about tonight. So.
Good evening. My name is Robert Kane. I'm a detective with the Detroit Police Department. I've been a police officer for 28 years. I've been doing detective work for 15 years in the sex crimes unit, where we handle cases where victims have been sexually assaulted by either known perpetrators or persons that they don't know. My specialty is females and males that have been victimized by persons that they don't know. We rely heavily on science and electronics. We also rely on our partners with the state police, the FBI, and other jurisdictions to try to bring these cases to a close for our victims.
Mine doesn't work. Yours works.
Hello. I'm Detective Sergeant Sarah Krebs. I work with the Michigan State Police, and I am your state Missing Children's Clearinghouse Manager and the Amber Alert Coordinator for the state. So a little bit about what I do. I collect information on missing juveniles and adults, and I try to assess the cases to get resources to go out and find them. So I do handle a lot of human trafficking cases, And I try to flag those cases and make sure that we get the right resources headed towards them so we can bring them back and get them back to their families. I also work with a group that we call Missing in Michigan. We started an annual event 7 years ago, and it is a movement to try to get more awareness about missing persons in our state, including the missing youth. And we're about to have our seventh annual event on May 6th in Livonia, so we would welcome you to attend that if you'd like. And feel free to ask me any questions pertaining to the missing youth and the statistics in our state. I think that they are a little bit surprising. We take over 1,000 missing juveniles a week in law enforcement. So about 1,000 cases are reported to us, and about 500 come back that same week. So it's a very busy job that we have. And I'll pass along to Mike.
Hey, good evening, everyone. My name is Mike Glennon. I'm a supervisory special agent in the FBI. I oversee the crimes against children and human trafficking units for the state of Michigan. First and foremost, I just want to say thanks to each of you for coming here today. I started working in human trafficking in around 2004 to 2005. And getting anyone to kind of understand, know, or listen to human trafficking in our area was relatively hard. So it's in large part many of the efforts that we've been able to accomplish, it's because of many of you out there and the advocates that you are. So I really want to thank you for that. In addition, I also oversee the Southeast Michigan Trafficking and Exploitation Crimes Task Force, SEMTEC. And in that, we are a conglomerate of 12 to 13 organizations, about 13 law enforcement professionals throughout Southeast Michigan that are dedicated to eradicating human trafficking within our area. More importantly, we have some key partnerships and friendships and relationships that we've developed over the years. And more specifically, we started a second task force, which is called the JAT, and we were able to get some funding through the Department of Justice. But more importantly, that helped us really develop some key relationships with service providers throughout the community, mainly Alternative for Girls, Vista Maria, the Salvation Army, Wayne County Safe. Are they here today? I know you guys are here somewhere. Oh, there they are in the back. So without their relationships and what they have been able to both teach us and help us, again, we would not have been able to do anything that we have to date. So to that end, I know they're not up here today, but if you get a chance, talk to them. They are a wealth of knowledge as well. So thank you for being here again.
Yeah. Greetings. I'm Sergeant Bobby Ward. I'm the officer in charge of the Detroit Police Department Sex Crimes Unit. I've been on the department for 28 years. I've been a sergeant for 15 years, and I've been working in this field of sex crimes for approximately 9 years now. As my Detective Kane pointed out, we're responsible for all matters of sexual assault as they happen in the city of Detroit. We've had partnerships with SAFE, a lot of public outreach groups. We've recently been charged with the responsibility of educating our first line responders on the signs and indicators for human trafficking, because you have a lot of officers who come in contact, just like you have EMS, doctors, nurses, school teachers come in contact with these victims, but if you don't know the indicators, you don't know what to look for. So that's really our most recent initiative, is educating the rest of our department on what to look for as it relates to human trafficking. We're also responsible for monitoring any and all trends that relate to sex crimes. By that, serial rapists, any type of internet nexus crimes, the stranger danger alerts as it relates to in and around the school district. And basically, a lot of what we do relies on our relationship with the public. So we're real big on public outreach. In the near future, you're gonna see us doing more with places of worship, educating them and their parishioners on what to look for. A lot of times you have these victims who are a little reluctant to come to law enforcement, but they may go to that teacher, they may go to that pastor, or they may go to that big brother, that coach. So those are our new eyes and ears, and right now that's where our initiative is headed now, educating the public and other first responders. Thank you.
Hi, folks. I'm Matt Conquest. I had the pleasure of a 28-year law enforcement career where I served as the detective sergeant for the Novi Police Department. I'm currently the director of law enforcement for Crime Stoppers of Michigan. And what our organization is, in brief, it's a nonprofit organization that kind of acts as a liaison between the community and law enforcement. We know that there are a percentage of the population that doesn't want to deal with the police directly. Maybe they have a fear of the police. Maybe they just don't like the police. Or maybe they have information on a crime where they'd be turning in a family member or a friend. That's where we bridge that gap. We offer a service to where people can come forward through our 1-800 speak up number, provide information that we give to the appropriate law enforcement agency to hopefully assist in their investigation. Over the last 3 years, we've assisted on over 600 cases and actually have paid out over $300,000 to our anonymous tipsters. So they remain anonymous by operating under a tip reference number that they follow up on. There's no caller ID. There's no recordings of any phone call when a tip is given. It's a good service, but the thing I want to emphasize is that we do hope that everybody deals directly with law enforcement, because there's not a better witness than somebody who will cooperate with police and bear witness at trial if need be. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Sarah Woodward, and I am a federal prosecutor at the U.S. Attorney's Office. My caseload is human trafficking and child exploitation, so I take the cases that Mike Glennon's team and then HSI investigate, and they bring them to me once they've been investigated, and then I take them through the court process. I think we all know what human trafficking is, and you're going to hear a little bit more about it tonight. Child exploitation at the federal level could be online enticement. It could be production of child pornography. We do see a lot of children victimized online, as I'm sure you're aware, and some of those cases come to our office. But I wanted to add to what Agent Glennon said, which is just that a lot of us up here are in law enforcement, and so we investigate and we prosecute cases, but that's only part of addressing this problem. The rest of that puzzle is the victim services providers and community members like yourself, because we only accomplish so much through the investigation and prosecution of crimes. It's an important piece, but this is really a problem that the entire community has to address. So thank you for being here tonight.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Rodney Riggs, and I'm a special agent with Homeland Security Investigations here in Detroit. Just a quick show of hands, how many people here have heard of Homeland Security before tonight? No? All right. How many people know that we investigate human trafficking crimes? Okay, not as many. Okay, I'm going to explain just real quick who we are and what it is we do as far as it relates to human trafficking. Our charter is a little bit different than the FBI's. We tend to focus on foreign nationals who are in the United States, a lot of times without legal status, and for that reason they're vulnerable to being exploited by these traffickers, okay? So under fear of being deported, which is probably not what's going to happen to them, but they're a lot of times don't know that, so they're easily victimized. Our agency uses what we call a victim-centered approach to these investigations, and what that means is we have a dual emphasis on identifying victims and stabilizing them and making sure they're safe and taken care of, in addition to conducting criminal investigations and prosecuting offenders, okay? We have 26 field offices across the country. All 26 of those offices have a human trafficking unit with agents specifically responsible for conducting human trafficking investigations. Last year, our agency as a whole launched about 1,000 human trafficking investigations, and that resulted in about 2,000 arrests and about 630 criminal convictions. So that's a pretty successful year in the arena of human trafficking. In addition to conducting those investigations, our agency has a pretty robust outreach initiative where it's fairly routine for us to go out and talk to local law enforcement, first responders, hospitals, ER employees, social service providers, and let them know, educate them on the crime of human trafficking, what it actually is, what their role is, what our role is, and when they should contact law enforcement when they have a situation that warrants it. Our agency has a tip line. It runs 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's right over here reflected on our on our propaganda table. It runs through DC, so there's a little bit of a lag time. But in addition to that number, there's also a national human trafficking hotline number that people can use. And that one's, again, staff 365, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And that one gets a little bit filtered out a little bit faster, usually within 24 hours. Agent Glennon or myself, our office gets those, and we will work the case as necessary. Last year, the state of Michigan had, 2015 is the latest stats that I have. There was about 800 calls that came in relating to Michigan. 200 of those resulted in criminal investigations. So about 25% of the calls that came in resulted in actual investigation. A lot of times when I put that stat out there, people ask, why such a small amount? Well, a lot of times information that comes in is not actionable. And also, I can give you just a quick example. About a month ago, we got a call in from a female. She was the victim herself. She reported it on that tip line. She wanted to talk further. We made a couple attempts to contact her and set up further interviews to get more information, which she was willing to do. But when the day actually came, she backed out and was unwilling to pursue it any further. Now, that is a call that's actually tracked, so that's counted in that 800. But obviously, it wasn't a criminal investigation that resulted from it yet. I mean, we're still pursuing it. But that's the types of things that we have to deal with in this arena. So that's what Homeland Security is, and that's what our involvement is in human trafficking.
I want to introduce a couple of more people, but before I do that, two things. If you have one of these cards, index cards, please write your question. I know you have a whole bunch of them. Make sure you write really legible so I can read them. And I will ask the questions to the panel and they will answer in turn, okay? Where's the? Raise your hand and she will come in. Hilda, ayúdame por favor con. Okay, so the next person I would like to introduce is my very special friend. He doesn't know that I'm going to ask him to come up here and say something. And that is Special Agent in Charge, David Jellios. FBI.
As soon as she said that, I knew she was going to ask me to come up here. Well, it's good to be here with you tonight, and we really appreciate Council President Jones hosting this event. And as you can see by our representation here on this panel, it's really a very important thing that we do in our field office. We have an entire squad dedicated to this, and the task force now is 10 years old, and they have incredible accomplishments. I don't want to steal Mike's thunder when he talks about this, but last year alone, we rescued 145 juvenile victims of trafficking in this area. We have a similar task force over in the Grand Rapids area, and we have people doing this work in Macomb County. So we're very proud of that, and we're glad to see the community involvement, because that's really the route we're going to need to take to bring an end to this terrible offense. So thanks for having us as a part of this today, and we're really glad to support the initiatives from all the agencies here. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next person I'd like to recognize, and also know that we do have translation services available for anyone that habla español. The next person I would like to bring up, I don't know if he wants to come, we'll see, right, is Acting Deputy Special Agent in Charge of the HSI Detroit Field Office, Steve Robinson. Where did he go? He's back there. He just went away. He's just going to wave and say hello. Now, I'm not sure if Chief Stacy Brackens is here. Oh, okay. And I also would like to recognize Director of DDOT, Dan Dirks. Now, as you see, these are our Detroit Warriors, right? And these are our family members that we are all working together for a collective issue. And the reason why this is very important to me, because I'll give you, last Monday, a young lady from Earhart, she was walking, she went to school and she didn't get there. And her parents do not have a relationship with law enforcement and reached out to another agency, community agency, and they just gave their daughter's name and phone number, and that was it. And next thing you know, the president of the West Verner Civilian Patrol, Nicole Fisher, over here that's sitting here, she reached out to me and she let me know, and I went into action. And I immediately called the phone number. I didn't get any answers. And I called the 4th Precinct Captain Solano. And I said, did you hear anything about this? Because the first thing you don't want to do is create anxiety, and you want to make sure you get the right information, right? So Captain Solano said, no, I didn't know anything about it. And immediately he went into action. Now for me, working with law enforcement these past couple of years have helped me to understand the relationships of everyone involved, but most importantly, to know how those relationships work internally and externally. And I also understand, for me personally, growing up in the city of Detroit, I did not have a good relationship with law enforcement. And look at me now. So what immediately happened is that Captain Solano sent investigators to the school, and he actually called the parent. He called the parents, and he went there and talked to them. And what happened? We ended up finding her later on that evening. Okay, this can only happen when you know exactly what to look for and who to call. In every district, we have neighborhood police officers. Two of ours are sitting in the back. I don't even see him anymore. Oh, LeBron is hiding over there. Officer LeBron and Officer Reese, he's waving. And we have another one, Officer Denmark. Here in Southwest Detroit, we have a very close relationship with all our city officials as well as our law enforcement, because it takes a village, right? So with that, I'm going to ask the first question. Almost daily, the news reports about missing girls and women. Is there a website or other means to know if, when they are found? Anyone can answer that?
Probably be me. Hello. That's probably going to be me. There's not anything super official that notifies when youth in our state go missing and are found. And the problem with it being is that volume. So when we're taking 1,000 missing youth, we don't have anybody to pay to do that full time to keep up a website, because it is so repetitive and they're going missing so often. I will say though that we started a group on Facebook, if anybody's on social media, called Missing in Michigan. And I can attest that about 90% of the information I get on missing youth in our state come from social media. So we will usually find out before the children are reported to law enforcement that they are missing, because the parents will post on social media first. And that is just the way our society and communities work now. So we try to keep that website up, and it's just a Facebook group, but we try to administrate it the best that we can. And most of the people that are running it are working with law enforcement. So we do have access to contact the agencies and run them in our databases, and to make sure that they're officially reported missing. And if they're not, we offer resources to those family members to get them officially reported.
Thank you very much. And I guess it's going to go to you, Sarah, again. What is the criteria on issuing Amber Alerts?
Okay. The criteria changed recently. So January 1st, our state went to an abduction-only Amber Alert, which is really what the Amber Alert was intended for, was to notify the statewide that a child has been abducted. Now, in years past, Michigan has had a very broad set of criteria, meaning that we would set off an Amber Alert for pretty much anything. Pretty much anything that endangered a child would be an Amber Alert. And that almost became a problem when they introduced the cellular alert, because now it was very invasive and it was waking people up and people were not happy with the Amber Alert anymore. And what we saw is that a lot of the cases that were getting the Amber Alert because of that broad criteria didn't really need the Amber Alert. They needed a good police investigation, but they didn't need waking people up in the middle of the night. So we made the criteria stricter. So now it only involves children that are under the age of 18, that have been the victim of an abduction. And anything that falls outside of that criteria, we made a secondary alert called the Endangered Missing Advisory. So we're putting out a lot more Endangered Missing Advisories than Amber Alerts right now, but we've been very successful with them. So we've actually had 15 Endangered Missing Advisories already this year, and all of them have been recovered safely. And we've only put out 3 Amber Alerts so far this year. So we've definitely made it stricter, but you see we've been successful in all of them. So I think it's working very well. Oh yeah. And as far as we used to have criteria that you had to have a license plate to set off the cellular alert, and that is no longer part of our criteria. So every Amber Alert will have the phone alert go off. However, we can restrict the mileage on it. So if we have, say, a suspect that we know is on foot, we don't need to wake up the people in the UP for that. So we will restrict sometimes within a 50-mile radius of the abduction site. Other times we don't have that information and we have a suspect that is mobile, like in a vehicle. We had one 2 weeks ago in Burton, and that ended up being a statewide Amber Alert because of the fact that we couldn't say where he was going. So just know that if you have the alerts turned on your phone, which you are able to turn them on and off, if it is an Amber Alert, it will be coming to your phone if you're within that radius.
Thank you. Next question. I would like to know if the... Oh, sorry. I would like to know if the girls rescued from the Victory Inn raid were given resources to be able to leave prostitution, and did they accept it? What is the status? If anyone can speak to that.
It didn't take long for the Victory Inn to come up to. Are you guys familiar with that case?
Okay. Yeah, it was a pretty successful operation, and we had that morning that we did the raids, we rescued around 14 girls. Now, as you can imagine, the state that they were in was not the best, but we had everything set up that we could. The help of our non-government organizations was outstanding. Every resource was made available to them, and there's a handful that took advantage of it, but you can't force the girls to do what they don't want to do. So unfortunately, we didn't get a large number of them out of that arena or that world, but I think that we're going to have another opportunity to get some to rescue some of those girls again, because we kind of understand where the traffic that was diverted from the Victory Inn when we raided it has moved on to another location, and some of the girls are there again. So we're going to come across them again, and we'll do our best. Lessons learned from what didn't work last time, and maybe it'll work this time, but we're still trying. Somebody have a... Yeah. Right. It's tough.
They have a lot of trust in me because I've helped them for 4 years.
Okay.
I just do street art.
I'll get your card. Yep. Or your contact information. Does someone else have something they wanted to ask about that? If okay. All right. Yeah.
I'm Butch Hollowell, the chief counsel for the city of Detroit. With respect to the Victory Inn, we did move as the city of Detroit to close that facility immediately. And that facility is closed and it's going to remain closed. And we've used the state laws as it relates to nuisance abatement and under our building safety and engineering code as well. So we're very pleased to work in coordination with the federal and state law enforcement agencies as well as the brave men and women of the Detroit Police Department as well.
Thank you. Next question. I have rescued 2 youth who sadly were part of the sex trafficking. I would like to know if you can recommend or identify homes that take victims in and that help them to reach safety.
Hello. Okay, so with the So with the juveniles, it's a little bit of a different process. So when we recover juveniles, if we're doing undercover operations and we recover juveniles, then we are required to call the Department of Health and Human Services because we're not able to take custody of them per se, and we have to let them determine what's going to happen with the children. A lot of times they go to our service providers like Vista Maria or another agency that's sanctioned by the Department of Health and Human Services. That being said, there are other organizations that can help off the streets or maybe Matrix Human Services. The issue, though, is that if they are juveniles who have been involved with the Department of Health and Human Services, they cannot go to those organizations. So those are organizations or Alternatives for Girls. I'm sorry for not stating them. But those are organizations that anybody can take their juvenile to if they are in a situation where the parent is concerned about them, especially being involved in sex trafficking and that type of thing. But those are organizations that a parent has to sign them into that and say, I would like my child to participate in this program. If they are involved with the Department of Health and Human Services, like the children are that we often recover, then they are not able to go to those types of resources because the Department of Health and Human Services can only go to certain places where they are able to place children. So if you have children that are involved in this type of situation and you want them to go receive services, then there are a variety of services that can provide help. Like I said, Matrix Human Services, Alternatives for Girls, Off the Streets. There are a few more. And if you contact the Salvation Army, they can definitely provide you with some other resources.
Excuse me. I get the hiccups. So the next question is, what should we as residents look at as suspicious human trafficking activity? What are some signs of human trafficking? Let me repeat it.
It really depends on the segment that you're in and the interface that you have with the public. I think, you know, the churches, community-based organizations, are going to have more of an opportunity to have some in-depth conversations. I think some of the indicators and outcries during those would be more direct. I think some of the schools, albeit if you're a teacher or someone that has a direct involvement at that level, you might see things more of an indirect level. But more specifically, you might hear things from the kids or from other parents and whatnot, so listening to the voices there. Now, directly, I think there's just, from the general public's perspective, is, you know, from the juvenile sex trafficking perspective, you have a child that has several cell phones, that has a number of electronics, they have hotel keys. You know, over time you start to see a branding. Most of the pimps, over the course of time, they consider these girls their property. So what they're gonna do is they're gonna brand them, and they're gonna put some sort of tattoo on them to make sure that everyone else knows that they belong to them. They're gonna be out for long periods of time, unexplained periods that they can't really justify where they're at, what they're doing. There's a disassociation as far as from the psyche. Another additional indicator is oftentimes trafficking and being involved in the sex industry, it coincides with drug use. And we see a huge epidemic as it relates to the use of opiates. So starts off typically with the prescription drugs and then easily progresses into heroin and whatnot. So again, there is no one simple way, but I think as you look at an individual and there's a number of circumstances surrounding them, the changes in them, as well as what possessions they might have, the detachments that they have from both their family and their friends, their interests at school, I think those are all a number of circumstances. And I don't know if Rodney, if you want to speak on more of the international perspective, but.
But. Well, I know that a lot of times in law enforcement, when people have questions about criminal investigations, they want an A to Z or a 1 to 10 list of what are the indicators. And we try to educate as best as we can, but it's kind of difficult to say if these 10 things happen, or if three of these 10 things happen, you definitely have trafficking. there's some nuance there to criminal investigation, so it's not black and white like that, okay? So we boil it down to, from an international or a labor trafficking of foreign nationals, what is the thing that the person is vulnerable to? And for us, it's usually if someone's, for example, let's say you're not in control of your own travel documents, or you don't have travel documents, and someone's holding that over your head, and without being educated in the ways of the our country and the laws here, those people don't understand that when the threat of them being deported because they don't have documentation, it's not a viable threat. That's not what our agency does. Okay, what we're trying to do is combat the traffickers. We're not here to find foreign nationals who are here without proper authorization, and we're not going to arrest those people, and we're not going to deport them. That's not our goal, okay? We wouldn't be a very effective law enforcement agency if that was what we did. We came in and you're being victimized already, and we come in and arrest you because you're here illegally, and then we kick you out of the country. It's just not the way we do things, okay? So it boils down to what is the thing that you're able to be controlled by, and it's different for everybody. So what might scare me isn't the same thing that would scare a female who weighs 100 pounds and doesn't speak the language, and yeah. I'm not sure I have that info.
What precinct or that zip code? What police precinct or zip code is the?
Sure, all of them. All of them? Is that helpful? Yeah. So it really depends. I mean, if you're looking at from a juvenile sex trafficking perspective, we do what's called heat mapping and indexing, which takes into account a number of different instances, albeit from a recruitment perspective, as well as if there's an arrest that goes on. Sure.
Excuse me. This is being recorded. That's why we have this process. And you're asking, your question could be something that someone else wants to know. And they're actually looking at this. So if you can just write it. But also know that all these beautiful people will be here if you have additional questions. And there are resources here. So it's good to have more questions at the end, because that means I did my job well. Thank you.
So the next question, what makes Michigan such a hotbed for this activity?
Okay, that's going to default to me again, sorry. So yes, the statistic that's usually thrown out is that the state of Michigan is the second highest in the occurrences of human trafficking. That's a bit off in that we have a very proactive group, albeit Rodney's and with us. And so it makes us one of the most prevalent areas based on those statistics, that we have a number of cases that are initiated, adjudicated, and arrests that happen. So that specific stat came out during an operation that we do called Operation Cross Country. And it's a 4 to 5 day period where we go out and do a number of sweeps throughout the community. And during that, there's 56 different groups that had done it simultaneously. And amongst those 56, we typically come in first or second during those periods of time. So now, that being said, the state of Michigan, and more specifically Detroit, does rank anywhere between 8 to 11, typically, on the national scale as it relates to both the recruitment of individuals for prostitution, sex trade, as well as a destination city or the occurrences that are happening therein. So that kind of gives some additional perspective. Now, the reasons being, we have a large number of at-risk youth, as well as we have close proximity to many of the major cities and thoroughways through Cleveland, Chicago, and whatnot, and easy access on over to the East Coast. And then additionally, we have the Canadian border. So there's a lot of different facets that bring into those statistics, but that kind of just helps paint, hopefully, a more accurate picture.
So what Mike is saying is that number two statistic really comes from the fact that we have law enforcement that are very invested in this area and do their jobs really, really well. He probably doesn't want to brag to say that, but the number two statistic comes from how seriously we take this crime. So we're lucky. I talk to people in other districts across the country that do my job, and sometimes they don't have that kind of support from law enforcement and that kind of investment in working on this area. And then I would also just say that a reason we do have a lot of human trafficking here is because wherever you have vulnerable people, there will be people who exploit those vulnerabilities. And I think you can all think about the challenges that we face in this district and the different vulnerabilities that people have. And people, the traffickers exploit that.
Just a moment. The person who wrote this particular card is really urging that you come up here for Sharon Owens. Could you please, and we'll speak to an agent.
Next question. Is human trafficking a worldwide problem or just a problem in Michigan? If it is a worldwide problem, who are the main smugglers of humans and who are the main smugglers or traffickers of humans?
Answer that. I think that's because there's so many. So really, like I said before, it can be a more coordinated criminal enterprise, or it can just be one person with one victim that sees a vulnerable person, either because they have a drug problem, because they're young, there might be mental health issues, and the trafficker is going to exploit that person either through sex trafficking or labor trafficking. So I'm not sure we can really make those kind of generalizations. It's really everywhere. It is around the world, and every kind of industry, even in labor trafficking, that you might imagine, what from restaurants to hotels to farm workers, I mean, it can really be anywhere.
Thank you. Next question. How do I protect myself from being abducted, especially if they're targeting public places in the suburbs, such as grocery stores?
I'll address that. I think that is a current myth that we're seeing a lot on social media. I've seen a lot of articles and posts about women and men saying that they've been followed by, you know, a group of young men, or there was an article in Good Housekeeping just last week about a mother that said that she was with her small children and that two men followed her around IKEA, and it creeped her out. Those are creepy people, but that doesn't mean that that is sex trafficking. And I think a lot of people are clumping that together to say every time that they see somebody checking them out that they think that they're being victimized. Yes, it may be, there might be a criminal element to that. However, that's not how our traffickers are getting their victims. These victims are coerced, they're groomed, most of them work on them for a long time because it's somebody that they know or it's somebody that they have befriended. These aren't people that are snatching girls off the streets. So we have to stop thinking that way, that every time you're walking alone in the mall that you're going to get forced into sex trafficking. That's not how we see it happen. We see it happen, it's coming into your living room. If you have a youth that has a cell phone, that has social media on it, that is how they are getting your girls. So you have to be more aware of that. So watch social media. The Kick Messenger app is absolutely the antichrist of missing kids. Absolutely. If your kids have that, really keep an eye on that or don't let them have it. But we see it on Facebook. We see it. We see youth recruiting other youth. It's not to say that these are all a certain demographic or a certain age group or just men. We see women recruiting other women to do this. The traffickers can be anybody. They could be friends of your children. So you really have to know your child and know who their friends are.
Go ahead.
To add to that, as parents of teenagers, you have to get into your child's business. You have to know what websites they're going on, who they're talking to, where they're going. They may say they're going to a friend's house. Make sure they're going to that friend's house that they say they're going to. Get into their business. Check their text messages also. See who they're talking to. You'll get a lot of information on your child and find out exactly what they're doing and where they're going and who they're talking to.
Old-fashioned parenting that a lot of us, I guess, born in the 70s know about. So with the Kick, how many of you, just to show of your hands, know about the Kick app? How many of you know before now that it was a dangerous app for your children?
K-I-K,
it's a, I think it's green, right?
I'm sorry.
It's green.
Oh, I'm sorry, he told me to say it again. It's K-I-K, it's a green and white app. Now, by all means, this is not the only dangerous app, but this is a major, a popular app that children use. And it's, like I said, it's K-I-K, not K-I-C-K, it's K-I-K. And don't think that because you cut off your child's cell phone service that, you know, oh, I'm good because they don't have service on their phone. Service on their phone is close as the nearest McDonald's. Mm-hmm. All they have to do, on a smartphone. You don't have to have cellular service to be able to use the internet on a smartphone as long as you're by Wi-Fi. So you think, okay, well, I'm good, I cut off their service, but no. And they talk to each other on these apps. And some apps are apps that you may not even recognize as a bad app. It could be an app that looks like a calculator. So if you go through your child's the settings and you see how much memory is being used for each app, a calculator shouldn't be using a lot of. They're not doing it, even if they are doing math, that's not, you know. So the point is, a lot of times these things are covered up. So like Detective Kane stated, you have to be your own detective in your own home. If their kid is not paying the bill, then that's your phone. So you go through and you find everything that's in there, and you are entitled, no matter how much pushback they give you, to go through and see exactly what they're up to, because other than that, you're not going to know.
So if you have a child that's in like a youth council or that's a part of an agency, that make sure you ask them, how are you contacting my child? And I know a lot of youth councils, they use that. But even after I share with them that important thing that we just shared with you, they still use it. So you have to be very adamant in your child's their interactions, and even with the after school programs or anything. I'm stressing because here in Southwest, I know of people still using it even after hearing the information from Valentina and from Dr. McGee. They still using it because they said it's easier. Phone call is easier, right? So this question says, the missing girls in Melvindale and Lincoln Park, were they related to human trafficking?
I don't know what one specifically they're talking about. I do know that there is one girl that is currently missing from Melvindale PD. I don't believe that she is involved in sex trafficking. We've actually had the FBI team look into that case. As far as I know, she is voluntary missing with her biological mother. And I don't know what other case they're talking about, but
I guess that person will come up to us later and expound on that. The next question is, what advice would you offer to the young people in attendance here in regards to being safe in their interactions?
Earlier today, I spent a large portion of the day in court, and I got to watch a 15-year-old give about an hour and a half testimony about how a group of individuals had exploited her over a four-year period at the time when she was 11, moving forward. And in that, they directed her to do all kinds of things that were just horrific. And it was probably one of the most difficult things for me to listen to and to watch. Albeit the entire time, she thought that she was talking to and befriending she was dating a 14, 15, and 16-year-old boys that were part of the same group. Obviously, all of them turned out to be men well within their adult age ranges that had contrived a very complex ability to exploit and target children. So I guess my cause goes out to both parents and children alike is, you know, for parents, you know, don't utilize the internet, your cell phone, mobile devices as a parenting mechanism, you know, that you think, well, I don't have to deal with my child because, you know, they're quiet right now. If they're quiet, there's a reason. So just be cognizant of that. And you know, to the kids that are out there, you know, having had the opportunity to speak with this young lady for, you know, a period of time, you could just see the devastation and the hurt and just the betrayal that was in her eyes as she faced these guys. And had she known, and she kept saying that, had I only known. You know, make good choices and make good decisions, you know. Imagine it that anything that you put on the internet is going to be distributed to everybody that you know and everyone that you could think of. And so if you wouldn't mind your grandmother seeing it, then it's probably safe to put out there. If there's any question that you don't want them to see it, then you probably shouldn't do it. And that is typically the gateway that leads to so many situations which end up leading into exploitation matters, in my opinion.
Can I add two things to that? I don't know if I have anyone in the room that reads Harry Potter, probably. Some hands for Harry Potter. All right. In one of the Harry Potter books, there's a young girl that is writing in a diary, and a lot of what goes on online, you can feel like you're confiding in someone and sharing your secrets. Turned out to be Voldemort that she was talking to, the Dark Lord, and then her parents tell her, don't talk to anything if you can't see where it keeps its brain. And I would tell children, don't talk to people that you don't know in real life, that you don't know who they are. And then the other thing would be to kids that if you get in over your head and you find yourself in a situation that's gone beyond your control, that you should go to your parents or go to a teacher or go to someone who can help you, and that you can't fix the problem by yourself, and people will help you. So it can be embarrassing and you can feel ashamed, but people who love you will help you.
I see so many young ladies that want to be grown, 13, 14, 15-year-olds that want to be 18, 19, and 20. My advice to you young ladies is stay a child as long as possible. You don't want the responsibility at your age.
Sorry. The next question. It seems that when we talk about human trafficking or sex crimes, it always seems that we talk about girls and women. What about boys and men?
Yeah, well, statistically, at least from us, as far as the human trafficking, I'm sure sex crimes could probably speak on it from a different perspective. But we, as far as transgender and boys and or males, we're at a very low percentage. Typically hovers around 2-3% of our total incident rate. So again, we don't want to preclude them, and I think they are a very at-risk and vulnerable demographic, and so as such, we definitely continue to take a look at it. But you know, I guess it's just kind of a statistics portion that most of the time, most of the encounters that we have are typically women.
I'm going to just piggyback off that for a second. Actually, what we're seeing in sex crimes in Detroit is what to the naked eye appears like there's an increase with male victimization as far as sex crimes, exploitation, so on and so forth, and transgender. When in fact, it's not so much that it's happening more, it's just people are less reluctant to come forward now, which is actually a positive thing as far as signing. As many of you know, in our culture, in the urban culture, it may be a shameful thing for a man to be emasculated or raped or something. So in the past, where they were reluctant to speak upon it and come forward, and it was just something that was put in a dark closet and the family handled it, you know, a lot of times these offenders aren't strangers on the street. Unfortunately, it's caregivers, it's family members, it's these mothers bringing these boyfriends to live with them. They don't know them that well. I'm just being honest, it's been stuff like that, and they keep it to themselves. Now people, a lot of it is because of the public outreach efforts that we've had, people aren't as reluctant to come forward, say it. If we keep that trend, yes, you're gonna see an increase of males being victim. But it's probably not that it's happening more, it's just the people are now brave enough to come forward and speak upon it.
And let me just add that in child exploitation cases, so children that are exploited online, I absolutely see boys exploited online. Maybe not quite as often as girls, but a good number. And that's because the perpetrators may pretend to be teenage girls, this happens a lot, and get the boy to create explicit images of himself, and then perpetrator may reveal himself to be a grown man and then use that embarrassment and shame to extort the child to continue to be compliant with the demands. So So I see boys exploited in the same ways, almost in a similar way to what Agent Glennon described about a girl who was online for 4 years exploited by a group of men. There are boys that are exploited in a similar way and don't come forward because of that shame and embarrassment.
Let me say one more thing, too, about keeping yourself safe as a child. I just want you all to be aware that a good portion of the traffickers that we come in contact with are not dirty old men. That's what you have to understand. Unfortunately, we are seeing more and more female traffickers that are your children's ages, or that are your ages, children. Basically, what happens is, either there's another trafficker who has said, you go to school today, you bring me two friends, or else. Or it could be a cousin, or a sister, or a young aunt, or whoever. And it's usually going to be, I'm not going to say usually, but a lot of times it may be somebody that you trust. So don't always be thinking, oh, it must be the boogeyman, that's who I'm looking for, that's going to, you know, get me, as long as it's my friend. Because, of course, you're going to trust your friend. And we have had several victims that I've worked with that got involved in something just following their friend. They trusted their friend. Sometimes their friend didn't know the danger themselves. But you just have to be aware and make sure that you think about where, if you have a friend that's asking you to do something, a cousin or whoever, really think about it. If you're not sure, or you end up at somebody's house and you don't know that person or what have you, like Sarah stated, it is okay to say, you know what, this is not going to work for me. I'm going to have to exit and not do this. But please don't always think it's going to be a male that's going to approach you and, you know, talk to you about some things. It can be that friend that you would never suspect. And she may not even be doing it because she wants to. She may be getting forced to do it. So you have to just be aware. Oh, wait, hold on 1 second.
Another thing for the young people here, from interviewing a lot of the young victims that we have recovered, one of the things that I've noticed through the interviews is that they're giving things up front. Here, nice clothes, nice shoes, get your hair done, get your nails done, those things like that. And they do it a lot for you. But eventually they're going to say, hey, it's time to pay it back. And that's how they get caught up. Okay? If you do this for me, when you start getting those favors asked after that, that's how the trend starts. Well, just do it this one time. That one time is going to be a lot of times over a long period of time. So to the parents also, the clothes that they wear, a lot of the young girls, almost all of them that I interview have on pink, because that's the fashion now. And it's expensive. Pink.
The pink, the brand.
The pink, that clothing brand. And that's what all of the young girls want to wear now. The pink in those boots. Uggs. Uggs. Right? So think about it. So parents, if you see your kids wearing that and you didn't buy it, you need to find out where they're getting it from. And it's not always going to be borrowed. They'll tell you, that's my friends. Well, I don't think nobody buying $150 jogging suits to let somebody else wear. So those are just some of the things just to pay attention to help keep your kids safe. And to the young people, like I said, when they start doing those favors for you, just try to think, why are they doing this for me? Am I going to have to pay them back?
Okay, thank you. Next question. Is it, or could it be, that human trafficking in our community is a gang-related problem?
I think it can be. I know around the country it definitely can be. If you've got a violent gang that sells drugs, selling girls and women is a similar enterprise. And girls and women can be sold over and over again, unlike narcotics that you have to constantly increase your supply. So, I don't know that we've seen that as much here, but we are on the lookout for it, and I know there are places around the country where they've had very violent gangs move over into trafficking of girls and women.
We do see young ladies that are sexually assaulted at sex crimes. They're sexually assaulted by gang members. They're usually passed around in these gangs. They talk about three, four, five guys all at once or taking turns on them. So, yes, it is a gang problem as far as sex crimes is concerned, yes.
Thank you. The next question is very basic but so important. What's the reason for human trafficking?
It boils down to money and control. It's, you know, kind of delineated out this way. As Sarah had just referenced, if you're trafficking a kilo of cocaine from, you know, let's say the Mexican corridor up into the Detroit area, your profit margin is approximately $10,000 for 1 kilo. That's kind of on the good side. So as far as sex trafficking of individuals and more specifically kids, if you have 3 to 4 girls that are working for you over a period of time, they typically have what's called a trap. That's what they need to make in each night. That's about $1,000. So if you have 3 to 4 girls, that's $3,000 to $4,000 that you're making on a consistent basis every night. And that's a renewable commodity, if you will. It continues to produce for you. So there's a huge profit margin associated with that. So ultimately, it boils down to that. And oftentimes, the charges associated with the narcotic distribution and some of the local and state charges are pretty lofty. So sometimes it's easier to stay under the radar with girls, if you will.
And the same method of control that you use, that the pimp is going to use to control the victims, he or she is probably also thinking, I can control her and she won't cooperate against, like she won't tell law enforcement what happened. And it can be a harder crime to prove. If you catch a drug smuggler with drugs, that's your crime right there. But this crime relies on witness testimony, and that's a challenging thing for anyone to go through.
So the next couple of questions are kind of similar, and a little bit I can answer that. So over here at the table, so I know Homeland Security. This is Valentina, and you have Will, Bushra, and Rhonda from the FBI. There are opportunities for you to take, to do something similar here to inform members of your church, your mosque, your organization, your staff at wherever that you work at, anywhere. And most importantly, there's opportunities to actually help educate children and young adults on how to protect themselves, to understand what to look out for. So I know for myself, when you signed in, there is more information that you can get, such as like this flyer right here. And there's a card that you can keep with you in your purse or in your wallet. You can share it with a person that you believe that is a victim, and it's resources and things like that. So feel free to speak with these beautiful people over here, and they will come to you, okay? They came to us today. They've done it many times. We've done it many times over the past year together. And I'm a total advocate for this because that's why I'm here. And you can be there too. That the whole goal of this event is to launch off a collective warrior, Detroit warrior family to protect our most precious resource. And that's our children, right? So. And the other question said, how are you working with local universities to provide internships and training for college students to help fight human trafficking? And I know that I will be speaking with, working with FBI again at the Academia del Pueblo conference at Wayne State University in the next couple of weeks. But please know we do, and we are working with local universities, but the additional part, I will leave up to the panel to ask, to answer. It says, for example, funding is usually a problem. So why not have a trained intern run a web page for the missing children? Of course, assuming they pass the background check.
Well, for us specifically, with the task force, you know, we have a lot of, so we have, like I talked about previously, the JAT, which is the partnerships that we have with most of our service providers. And community members, and so that's kind of the umbrella we have there. But so from the law enforcement perspective, though, we're somewhat limited as far as what we can do because it's a bit of an arduous process to get through the background investigations. But we do a lot of liaison and coordination through our community organization groups. So more of an informal process. And I think there is a lot of opportunity for community members, community-based organizations to be a part of that.
Next question. Is organ harvesting common? Because it says, what are all the different reasons for human trafficking? We kind of answer that. And is organ harvesting common in these cases, I believe?
Boss, you want to speak to that? No. There's a, I guess, a, I wouldn't say common, no. There's a myriad of different reasons why trafficking may occur. I think probably the most prevalent and most predominant would be the labor trafficking and the sex trafficking here within our region. But doesn't mean that it doesn't exist in other venues. And as Sarah had previously indicated, around the world and, you know, amidst every different type of industry, if you will. But no, not common. No,
and I think we see human trafficking is really about money, like Mike had said.
Thank you. Next question. I know how much the Department of Homeland Security, investigations do to educate children and to educate the communities on cyber safety. So this question is very important. We'll go ahead and ask it. Can a young girl who thinks she's grown and who decides to put nude pictures of herself online or text pictures of herself be charged with a crime?
Sarah? So legally, depends on your jurisdiction, the answer could be yes. I think that that is not what happens. And certainly federally is never what happens. We don't charge victims in being a part of their own exploitation. Occasionally you'll hear news stories from around the country where maybe a school is telling kids that they could be charged. I think everyone is looking for a way to stop kids from being vulnerable in this way. But it's not something that we do, and I think that it's not the way to solve the problem. I think what we do is we focus on the people that are exploiting the kids. I think the bigger deterrent for kids themselves is not the fear of prosecution, but you know that picture can be sent around to the whole school, and I think people are becoming more familiar with that very real risk because it happens again and again. And I think telling kids and reminding kids of that risk is a better thing to tell them than to tell them not to take the picture because they could be prosecuted for exploiting themselves. That just doesn't make sense. But don't do it because you might regret it. It's out there and it'll stay out there. And people who get it might then use it to exploit the kid, the child. We do see that where someone may get the picture secondhand and then they reach out to the original, to the person, the child who produced it and say, if you don't take more pictures of yourself, I'm gonna send this out further. So anyone who takes those pictures is vulnerable for a very, very long time. And that's why we should tell kids not to do it.
Thank you. What is being done in school districts, inner city, and suburbs to educate our youth on human trafficking and cyber safety?
I mean, I can speak to it from our perspective. So it really varies into each school district onto their own. Each of them have their own policies, procedures, and how they want to deal with the situation. I will say that pretty much all the districts within our community have expressed an interest and some sort of plan in order to educate, talk to, and initiate conversation amongst the children, and then more specifically kind of parlay that into some more in-depth conversations with the parents. So I will say that there's been a huge initiation over the last several years for community school districts to initiate those conversations.
Just to add to that, we at Crime Stoppers, we have somebody on staff. His name is Willie Burton. Willie's a former NBA player, number 9 overall draft pick a number of years ago. But Willie runs a program from Crime Stoppers called Project Safe Campus. Project Safe Campus is basically Crime Stoppers within the school. We didn't want to put crime in there, so that's why we called it Project Safe Campus. But it's a way for the school, for the kids within the school, to keep their school safe by reporting criminal activity, including human trafficking or suspected human trafficking, by reporting that information to us anonymously. So there are programs out there that will assist law enforcement in fighting this offense.
Why are Latina and African American girls missing more nationally? What are the statistics?
I don't think that is a true statement. I don't know exactly what the breakdown is, but I can tell you that the missing statistics cross all races, all ages. Maybe if they're talking about sex trafficking, I don't even think that that would be a demographic that we keep. We see it with all different groups. This touches everybody, especially with missing children. If you think about The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy ran away. I mean, it's been a common practice in our society for a very long time that youth run away, and it doesn't stop because of your race, religion, really anything. We have adults that run away. It's just not against the law to do it. So I don't really see that it's a certain group. It's really, as far as I see, it's boys, it's girls. It goes really the youngest age that we see all ages, but the voluntary runaways usually start around 10 or 11. And they go all the way up, you know. We take missing reports all the way up to the age of 21. So it's federal law that law enforcement take those reports. And that is something that I hear a lot from the community, that they went to a law enforcement agency to report their loved one missing and they were turned away. So you should know that if you're under the age of 21, that they can't do that. That there are laws out there. There's the federal law, the Missing Children's Act of 1982, enforces law enforcement to take a missing persons report. And then there's another one called Suzanne's Law, which was passed in 2006, the Protect Act, that covers ages 18, 19, and 20. So if you're being turned away, you can always contact the Missing Children's Clearinghouse, and then I can make sure that agency takes that report, which we've had to do before.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. What legislative improvements are there to punish the individuals proven guilty of human trafficking?
Well, federally, we have really stiff penalties. I guess we haven't talked about that yet, but if someone is convicted of human trafficking and under federal law, sex trafficking of a minor, the mandatory minimum is 10 years. It starts at 10 and it goes up to life. If that the trafficker uses force, fraud, or coercion, which usually they do, so that can be an adult or a minor, the penalty starts at 15 and goes up to life. So the penalties are very stiff, and we try to choose the cases to prosecute federally that warrant that kind of stiff penalty. And the state has good penalties as well, so I'm not sure that it's a legislative problem so much as it's, you know, like I said, when you have vulnerable people, they will be exploited, and we all need to work together to get people in those situations out of those situations and hold the traffickers accountable.
How much interviewing and interactions do the agencies continue with the victims? And are they allowed to be a part of the task force process, of this task force process?
The victims themselves?
See.
Nicole, did you want to speak to that end? I mean, so for us, I mean, oftentimes my team interacts and obviously gets to introduce to an individual on site, either responding to an operation or an undercover activity. But subsequent to that, depending on the case, we do continue our conversation and help, but more specifically, that's where Nicole will step in at that point from victim services to really meet the needs of the individual. My investigators kind of at the front end, they really want to develop that relationship to figure out not only the circumstances that happened that night, but more so what led to the circumstances that got you there and who is responsible. And oftentimes when we intervene or get to know them, exploitation has been occurring for a number of years at a number of different levels. So that's what we want to know about. We realize that as an investigative entity, we can't meet the needs of the child or the individual, and that's where we rely heavily upon our partnerships of those in the back, as well as kind of the coordination that Nicole makes. So on to that, I mean, we don't really have, we work with them occasionally, but I'll let Nicole speak to that.
Well, any victim that we come across, be it a juvenile or an adult, as long as we have had some, as long as we've come in contact with them, I don't know how to say it, but as long as we've come in contact with them by any means, they can be a person that receives services from the FBI. So even if we are assisting a local law enforcement agency with an investigation, as long as we have had some type of contact with that victim for a law enforcement purpose, then I myself can provide services to them. And that can go on forever. I have people that still contact me from 4 or 5 years ago. It just depends on the situation. But in regards to what it is that we're trying to provide for them, I try to give them resources that and get them in contact with my partners in the back of the room to get some long-term resources depending on what they need. But it just is a case-by-case basis depending on whether or not they need substance abuse services or clothing or whatever it is that they need. But even if it's 2 years later and they need something, they can give me a call and I'll do my best to assist them. So we try to provide services on an ongoing manner.
Okay, so as you can see, if you were paying attention to me too, and Valentina, we have a lot more cards here. It is now 7:30, and I want to be sure to respect everyone's time that you invested in today. So I'm going to wrap it up, and President Brendan Jones will be coming up following soon after. So I hope that this day, this evening, was very, very helpful. I would like to let you guys know, when I start getting my Amber Alerts, and I would, and I'm going to be honest and transparent, like, man, it's waking me up, or whatever, right? Then I start to pay attention, and I started noticing, like, wait a minute, all these kids are around the same age, right? And we don't talk about it. We don't talk about things that are traumatic or historically traumatic in our communities, or we may feel like it's something that we need to be ashamed of. There's nothing to be ashamed of. Professional profilers know exactly how to get to us. You guys understand that? They know how to get to us. They know how to get to our children. So we have to be very adamant in working with all the people that we've elected to represent us, work with law enforcement. I can tell you, get over it. Because if your child comes up missing, and I spoke with an undocumented father, and he was like, I'm not sure, I don't have a relationship, and I understand. Trust me, I do. But if it came to your child's life, what would you do? You have to make that decision. This is happening too many times, and last August it happened. The little boy was taken 4 doors down from his house. The grandmother put it on Facebook, messaged someone else. That message ended up coming to me, and then I, in turn, spoke to my other Avengers, right? And we were able to find him, but the damage was done. Broad daylight, 4 doors down. We have to start speaking to our neighbors. I don't care if they are renting. You need to talk to your neighbors, talk to the store owners, create a relationship with your school. We have to be active. And maybe I'm speaking to the choir, but maybe the now is the choir turn to speak to everybody in the congregation. Y'all feel me what I'm saying? So with that, if you want to do this again, and I'm hoping for the next 30 minutes or whatever time we have left, come and get some water and some chips. Please feel free to speak to any one of us up here to get more information, because my goal is for you to be like me, active, and bring this information back. I have, so the Detroit Department of Transportation, our children ride on a bus. When you're dropping your kids off, while you're driving to the school, pay attention who's walking. And don't be afraid, because I remember back in the day, now I might be like dating myself, if I did something wrong and my neighbor saw it, they would say something to me,
And by the time I get home, my parents already know the whole story. And I didn't have any, so we have to have courage at this time and age where the digital divide is creating us further, pushing us further away from us. If the cell phones go down, we're gonna have to turn around and look at our neighbor and speak to each other. So let's train our students, our kids, our children, our young adults, our 28-year-olds, get off the phone and start paying attention. There's some type of engagement that you can do right now. It is not rocket science. And I will just have to say, I really appreciate every single last person in here, especially my panelists, because now I have friends with people I've never thought I would ever have before in my life. But now I feel like that anxiety that I used to have of not knowing, I no longer have that. I have the power of knowledge and I have access to other power sources. And that's us, that's them, and that's you. And so together we can, si se puede, and please, please, take advantage of this. You can go on, if you were here earlier, you saw on YouTube videos, it has stories and everything. Sit your children down and show them. Me? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm not trying to preach. But sit your children down and show them, and your young adults, sit them down, watch the videos, create some communication, okay? And this one I'm going to actually hand to President Jones herself and see what she says about it. And with that, Ms. Brenda Jones.
Again, I want to take the opportunity and ask you to take the opportunity with me in joining me in thanking our panelists for being here. I also would like to take the opportunity to acknowledge, and they have been acknowledged already, some of them, Special Agent in Charge, David Delos, FBI Detroit, thank you. Yes. Chief Stacy Brackens, thank you. Yes. Chief James Craig, thank you. Thank all of you for being here. Thank you. I'd like to acknowledge our DDOT Director, Dan Dirks. My colleague, Councilmember Leland's staff. Councilmember Castaneda Lopez's staff. Daryl Pritchard for Motor City Switch. Members of the Citizens Police Academy. The MPOs from the 4th Precinct. Lieutenant LaShawna Potts, the Chief's Office. Sister Student Captain Missy Muhammad. And Student Minister Troy Muhammad was here as well. And also our Congresswoman Brenda Lawrence's office. And again, I wanted to just, my boss is telling me someone else. Advanced disposal. All right, thank you, thank you. All right, and again, all of you all, thank you. And I know, blame it to my head and not my heart if I am missing someone, but I thank you all for being here because this is such an important thing that we must all say, enough is enough. We're fed up. We're tired of this. And it's going to take all of us to come together, to work together, to be able to put an end to that. To this. And to that means what I am doing is I am sponsoring a resolution to convene a Detroit Human Trafficking Commission. And what this commission is going to do is going to bring together various resources, community groups, social services, law enforcement, the judicial community, educators, religious institutions, and funding sources to coordinate the activities in our area. What we want to do is bring awareness to youth, bring awareness to parents, schools, businesses, and others on the signs of human trafficking, offer training to handle real life incidents, and to promote preventive measures. We have to do it, because I'm convinced that we can reduce this problem in our city. It's the, remember, second largest state. We can reduce it in our city. You know, there was recently an incident that occurred at the notorious Victory Inn. And with the joint law enforcement operations, they was able to close it down and handle what needed to be handled. So I say thank you. So we're going to continue to set up a series of meetings and forming subcommittees for everyone to participate and mobilize and join together to end this problem. There was a card that I received, and basically it asked, could we do a larger meeting, possibly at Cobo Hall, to convene more people together to get the word out? I'm willing and I'm ready. And because we have to work together to solve this issue in our city. It's going to take us all to work together. And this room should be filled. This room should be filled with the problems that we have in this city alone. So I am ready and I am willing to do whatever I need to do with whomever I need to do it with to solve this problem and to help solve this problem. So that means we have already talked about, if you're interested in having someone come out any place to talk about the problems that we have, let's do it. I want to give the panel an opportunity, if there's anyone that wanted to have closing remarks, to have closing remarks. Okay, they all said, I'm tired, I had a long day. But do not go any place, because if you have any questions that you didn't want to write down, you know how we often think that question is a dumb question, so I'm not going to ask it. If you want to come and address the panel with your own personal question, feel free to do so. Feel free to go to the side, get the resources that you need. Feel free to talk to anyone that you need to talk to. Again, thank you so much. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for all that you did to help convene this. I'd also like to thank our people from council who have been working all day to make sure we had mics, the sound. Thank our executive protection unit. Thank you all. And I'm going to stop right here to give you that extra time that you need to take care of whatever you wanted to take care of. Get up, take care of it, don't run out. Thank you.